the Amazon rainforest with Robert and Dee Dee. You may not make it out alive. I was just trying to get to the Oregon coast and we ended up in the Amazon instead.
It was amazing.
I love ferns. Oh my goodness, I love ferns.
Somebody's got a wooden measure sawmill.
Ooh.
This would be the cobble.
This
year.
This is beautiful.
Oh, look at the, oh, okay. We got a little timber
frame.
No,
we gotta keep going because we're late for the...
All right.
We're late for the ball, princess.
This lovely little cottage company wouldn't allow us to take video while we were there. So I will try to walk through all of our pictures and explain what we were seeing. They used a lot of round wood for the roof support system. You can see how pretty it is. There were tiles, there was brick, there was rammed earth for the floors, so a lot of variety. Rocket mass heaters in some of the buildings, just plain rocket heaters in others. You can see the firewood and the homemade tables. Everything looks very rustic, very attractive. To my mind, everything felt a little bit like a hobbit hole. You can see the pretty plastered walls and the handmade door. This is the outside of one of the structures. The most striking thing to me is the living roof. This is a freeform roof support. A lot of these are root timbers. This is an urbanite foundation, which would be concrete slabs that were broken up from other locations and used as the foundation stone to keep moisture away from the cob. This is one of the very pretty little kitchens. Very light and airy. It makes me think of Tuscany. Hand-woven baskets, handmade tables. This is the community kitchen. You can see the rocket mass heater. Another freeform table. This is a community space. So they have tables, they have library space, they have dishes. Another, I think this is a masonry oven. Not sure what to call it, but they do cook on it. Another rocket mass heater type of bench. Everything, there's not very many completely man, or completely, what's the word? Everything is man-made, but not machine-made. They also have some straw bale walls. It seems like the point of cob building is experimentation. What can we do? A lot of these buildings are older. They have really stood the test of time. Obviously, this is a fireplace. The sculpture in the walls amazes me. This is to let sunlight in to add a little bit of warmth in the summer. They do have electricity. I remember at House Alive, one of the things that he enjoyed making the most were the lights to make them beautiful. It looks like they didn't take quite as much care in their lights, but they do have electricity. You can see how far the roof overhangs over the building to protect the cob from rain. This is in Oregon, so they get quite a lot of rainfall. This was in, I believe, it was Jacksonville. Was it Jacksonville? I'll have to see if I can remember. We went to several places, but anyway, it was along the coast of Oregon. You can see from the ferns, they do get a lot of rainfall. The area itself was just absolutely beautiful. The trees were enormous. Sometimes you really couldn't even see the structures for all the vegetation that was growing on the roof. Beautiful gates, handmade, hand-woven gates that went from one building to another. A lot of these buildings were connected by a courtyard. You can see the fence. I guess you could call it a fence. It's a wall. The wall connects different buildings. You can see an outdoor grill. They do cook outdoors. You can see the freeform timbers and the beautiful sculpture, the horses on the wall. Look at the top of that wall and you will see the shingles that are to protect the top of the wall so that it doesn't absorb water, so that the water can run off. It just goes to show what fun you can have with these natural materials. Aren't they beautiful? A lot of these structures were actually created by students. So the reason you see so many different buildings and so many different structures and the walls and everything is that each one of these was a project that they created just to teach students how to use the cob. Again, you can see the urbanite, the rubble that was used to create the foundation to keep the cob out of the damp. At House Alive, they did say they liked to let the structure dry for a little while before they added the windows to keep them from cracking. But it does look like on these windows, they don't have cob above the window, which means so the weight wouldn't be crushing the window in this situation. They did use pond liners underneath the living roof, and that keeps it from leaking into the home. That's what you'll see the black is along a lot of these structures, is a pond liner. This is one of the creators, one of the founders of the company. She was very generous to come and give us a personal tour. And you can see how much fun an artist would have in using cob as a building medium. And again, because Oregon, certain parts of Oregon can be very damp, you wouldn't think that cob would work, but you think about some of the original places where cob was used would be in England, in very damp areas. So your foundation makes a huge difference in whether or not your building is going to survive and whether or not you have an overhang. There is a lot of thought that goes into how you design your building. They had dotted the property with a lot of these little houses that were projects for students. This one was a guest house. Inside it felt pretty open and airy and just magnificent. If you had a family, this would probably be pretty cramped, but for a single person who knows that they're going to spend most of their day with the rest of the community over in the kitchen or outside working, I think this is very idyllic. This one did have a little rocket stove in it. This is an outdoor stove is what I understood. I didn't really see how this particular part worked. It could be that the rocket stove is on the outside, and it looks sizable until you get Robert from Swamp Creek cabin in it, and then it starts to look like a pretty small little house. But you can see the roof looks a little different on this one. It slopes a little bit differently. At House Alive, we found that they would put up wool blankets on the outside as a curtain to hold heat out, but here they have so many trees. It was very cool. It wasn't overly warm. So they have kind of a different set of parameters than what we found at House Alive. Here's some, I guess you could call it cordwood, but it's part of the path. We've done this on our homestead because we're not real wet. And this is a cob wall that masonry bees have made a home in. When you don't put the plaster on, then the bees make their way into the wall and use it as a hive. So it is important once you have your cob finished to get it plastered quickly so that you don't have a problem with insects. These were in all the walls that hadn't been plastered, and over time they would probably damage the structural integrity, but since it's just a wall and not a building, It's probably not as big a deal as it could be. I was trying to find a way to show you the bee itself But dang, they moved fast. I can't think of how many pictures I took. So this is the piece de resistance. This is their actual cottage where the founders live. And the artwork on it and the level of finish on it just is gorgeous. They did plaster it quickly. You can see the lilies, the beautiful, beautiful windows. It is a two-story structure. And it's surrounded by this beautiful wall. The wall is to keep deer out on this property. And while we were there, we did see deer on the other side of the wall browsing, but they didn't come inside the wall, so it obviously had done its work. Like I said, I think this is just the cutest little cottage I've ever seen. I tried to get it from every angle. It was a bright day, and it was hard to find a spot where I didn't have some pretty deep shadows. So I pretty much just took as many pictures as I could click fast enough. You can see the skylights from the top of the living roof. So these stairs were part of the delight of this little cottage. There were some stairs in some other places and in some other cob buildings that we've seen that were really kind of scary to walk up, but those were actually pretty nice. This is a little, I'm not sure what kind of stove this is. It still looks like a rocket mass heater because you can see the barrel in the back. Here is the upstairs. It's not, this part isn't a bedroom. It's more of like an artist studio. You can see the lighting's soft and that an artist must have lived here. You can see all the beautiful, I don't know what to call it. Is it paint? This is one of the skylights. There was a bamboo trim along the inside of it. They did have quite a lot of bamboo at this location. And they also finished the ceiling with the bamboo. They used some wire wrapped around the bamboo to hold it together and then bamboo strips, as you can see here. And I believe they had fabric underneath it on the side of the ceiling. A little bit closer. I think the finishes in these were really nice. There's another skylight. They had two skylights. And this would have been a labor of love because that would be very tedious trying to get all that bamboo wrapped. Here it is in its entirety. You can see it has kind of a little bit of a balcony system for sitting, for art. It's not a cluttered space at all. There's not more furniture than you would need, but there's plenty of places to sit and relax and just enjoy the space. The railing itself is kind of free form and fun. And again, another shot of the railing, of the art, and also of the downstairs. It actually was very, very nice, the curving. Their Swamp Creek cabin, looking at it, because they're getting their own home put together and finished and remodeled, I think this was very fascinating for them. It was fascinating for me, fun things to dream about. There were lots of windows. You can see how pretty the kitchen is. There is a better view of the kitchen. It has a beautiful sink, again, lots of windows, propane cook stove, counters that are very freeform. And I love that the dishes are beautiful. Beautiful and simple to match the house. They have worked really hard to make it artistic and pleasing to your eye. They made sure that the view outside was beautiful, which I think is important in a small space. You want to have plenty of outdoor recreation and activity. There's the toilet. I don't remember if they had plumbing or not. This could be a composting toilet, but it could be an actual flushing toilet. There's the stove again in a little better detail. Their heat shield in the top is made out of tin can lids, which I thought was brilliant because they are, again, quite decorative. They did want to protect the floor of the next room up from the heat. There were some buildings that were not used very much anymore. or maybe had never been used. I think they were student projects that then they didn't have people living there and they didn't get finished. You can see that they didn't get plastered and that the living roof didn't get finished. So we didn't go in those quite as much as we did the others, and they looked like they had been used for storage. Oh, speaking of which, the beautiful little cottage cost them $5,000 to make. And it looks like the same care was taken with these other buildings, but they weren't finished. They have the nice sinks in it. People could live in them. They have a lot of people that come and stay when they're doing projects, when they're doing building workshops. But the rest of the time, I believe it's just the two founders that live up here. There is a crack in this particular home. Conrad from House Alive said that it's really not a big deal to patch those up. You put plaster into them and they dry and they're just fine after that. Here it shows some spaces that are a little bit dilapidated. They look like they weren't necessarily made of cob. Here's another spot where they had put stainless steel, what's it called, the scrubby stuff they use on pans. They put them in a crack to keep mice out. Again, maintenance and having someone live in a home and keeping up on the tiny little things as they pop up is as important in a cob house as any other house. I think a lot of this just kind of goes to show, don't be afraid to try. Be smart, you know, you don't want to endanger someone's life, but try. Experiment. I'm not sure how much of a snow load they get here. I would imagine not much, because in our area, a roof that was almost flat like that would have problems, especially I think if it was a round wood support, not dimensional lumber, not the bracing. To my understanding, they get rain here, but not a lot of snow in our area. I think the slope of this roof would cause a lot of problems. The chairs in the window just make me think of a cozy day at home with your granny after making cookies. It screams cottage. Another really pretty view of the urbanite in the foundation. I think it's just lovely. You wouldn't know that it was a nasty concrete. A cute little stool, freeform stool. Just another one of those personal touches. And then there were a couple girls that were in the tour that were curious about why I was taking pictures. And so during this whole clip, they're asking me what I'm doing and why I'm there. Underneath the bedroom balcony is the living room. It's low. The people who built these homes were not tall. And so if you're tall, it probably wouldn't be a very comfortable home for you. The stairs were carved out of one piece of wood. They weren't impossible to get up, but they weren't necessarily easy to get up either. And the ceiling and walls in the upper bedroom loft were made out of fabric. They were finished with fabric, and I thought it added a very nice, cozy, peachy feel to it. The fabric kind of matched the texture of the walls themselves. Makes it think maybe of a Bedouin tent or something like that. Just charming. Again, lots of windows. The walls are deep on a cod. On a cob building, and so having lots of windows helps with the fact that they're kind of quite recessed and can be overshadowed. So the freeform round wood slash dimensional lumber roof is interesting. Again, it feels more like a sculpture. I'm not sure how it's staying in the wall. Again, if you are in a place with heavy snow loads, I don't know how well this would work. And because it's a living roof instead of a metal or shingle roof, would the snow slide off easily? If you had to get up and shovel it, would your foot go through the roof? I just don't know what the structural integrity of it is. Pretty wood floors. I'm not sure if they were reclaimed or if they were milled on the property. I'm not sure. A view of the kitchen. All the kitchens seem to feel kind of similar to each other. They're very careful with their colors. It's all freeform. Again, I think they were intentional with the bedspread. Everything, they were very intentional with it. They wanted to showcase the house and enjoy living in it, not have it feel cluttered. But I have noticed there's no closets. Like, there's no closets in these homes. There's no storage space. If you lived in a place with four very extreme seasons, different from each other. I'm not sure there would be enough storage in these homes to be able to store your change of clothing and maybe some food for emergencies. If you're a prepper or food storage kind of person, you would definitely want to design in some more storage. Some really cute little frogs on a wall. They are always expanding. It's a good thing they have a lot of property because, my goodness, they have so many different projects. This is one that is still wet. It to me, it looks like a wall, but it could be anything because, again, they're still working on it. Isn't this pretty? This is a newer structure. You can see they plastered it. The pretty half door. You don't necessarily have to have a lot of skills in order to be able to come here and make something fantastic. Here's the top of a living roof. I don't think that this one was a pond liner. I think they were experimenting with something else, but I'm not sure. I think maybe it was tarps. Okay, so this one was tin and then carpets over the top, I think is what that was. So tin underneath, carpets on top. This one has straw bale in it. There's the rubble trench. So that's the base of your foundation. You have broken up small pieces of rocks in the trench for drainage. And then on top of that, you put either your earth bags or, in this case, your urbanite, which is what that is. That is concrete broken into flat slabs. And that that gives you drainage. It allows you to keep your cob from getting wet. And you don't want your cob to ever have wet feet because then it undermines the structural integrity of the whole building because the bottom layer will turn into mud, and then if that squishes down, then what happens to your building? Here is some cordwood, which is to take lengths of wood and place them in your cob. It needs to be stable wood that isn't going to shrink too much, otherwise you'll have holes. You'll have space around your cordwood. There is the round wood roof. There you have some not dimensional. It looks like it's rough cut, non-dimensional wood. I don't know what the R value is of cob. I don't know how well it insulates. This area doesn't get terribly cold in the winter. That is still new cob, you can see, because the holes, you use a stick to press and poke and prod, and leaving those holes allows the plaster something to affix to when you apply the plaster. I have yet to see any concrete that was actually used for stability and wasn't just a repurposed chunk of concrete. There's some bamboo in that roof. You see the big green limbs. That is a large bamboo, which they do have growing on the property. Pretty neat. And they've lashed it together rather than using nails. Something else that, again, is interesting. So there's a course of cob that has been worked in and is getting ready for another round. There's Robert from Swamp Creek Cabin going in, and you can see how small the building is when you have somebody that is as tall as him standing next to it. And one of the things they did mention is that they cannot be seen from satellite. A cob house with a living roof is not visible. From satellite. There's their bamboo that's growing on the property. They had quite the little thicket. I would think with a stove that small, you'd be feeding it all the time. A writing desk, a handmade chair, the roof, the way that everything fits together is so pretty. That is the underside of the bed. That is just a big old honking rock that they put cob around. But, I mean, a lot of these classes, it's just about experimentation. It really isn't about getting it perfect. It's about playing with the material and seeing what happens. Lovely windows. Very minimal on the decoration. Makes it easier to pay attention to how pretty the house is. Handmade door. We weren't sure why the door had been taken off on this one. I would imagine that these structures, you build your first one really small, you learn from it, and then you build one a little bit bigger. To my mind, doing something like a little chicken coop would be ideal. Do your chicken coop first, and then do a goat barn, and then do your house. Isn't that pretty? We've spent a lot of time sleeping in not normal, conventional mattresses, and we've found that it actually doesn't bother our back. Isn't that interesting? It does initially. Initially, it takes a little getting used to. But after a little while, you get used to it, and you actually sleep just fine. I think they offer this one as an Airbnb, if I remember correctly. I think these would be awful if you didn't have enough lighting in them. And again, this is a very wet area. They get a lot of rainfall, and yet their mud huts have not deteriorated. We went for a little hike up and saw a gorge there at the top of the hill we could see down. And it was just absolutely beautiful. There are two ways to get rich. You can make more money or you can require less. I thought that was a fitting end to our trip.